happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the house this morning. Thank you for all you do for your families. Okay, she ran upstairs, so I catch my breath. I'm going to share something from Psalm 18 this morning. I'm going to read out of the Amplified Bible. I love you fervently and devotedly, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer, my God, my keen and firm strength in whom I will trust and take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower. I will call upon the Lord, who is to be praised, so shall I be saved from my enemies. What comfort we have that we know the rock, amen, that we are part of the rock, that we are one with the rock, amen, that we have a high tower to go to, yes, that protects us from all of the storms that rage in this world, from all the evil that comes in this world, a firm foundation in whom we can trust, who we can rest, a place where we can go and let go of all of our cares and our struggles, and a place where we can just come and be with him. Amen. But it's not just us, is it? Where do the people, where do the hurting in the world go? Where do they go? They come to us. Right. It is time for the church to rise up and become the beacon, to become the house of refuge, yes, for those who are hurting. We struggle with our own things, but those are for us to deal with the Lord in our closets and here with each other. But this world is dying and hurting and screaming and reaching out for hope, yes, for truth, for peace, for love, for joy. And it is us that they come to. It is us that the Lord sends as a message of hope, as a message of salvation. We know who to turn to. But are we leading those who come into our lives in the same direction? Right. Psalm 43 says, "Oh, send your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then will I go to the altar of God, my exceeding joy. Yes, with the lyre will I praise you, O God, my God." People are waiting for someone to send the light, yes, to send the truth before they will come to the Lord, before they will go to his house. Well, listen, that is our job. You know, I am convinced that all of the battles, all of the situations in our life are just to distract us from our true purpose. Our true purpose is to be salt and light. We are the representatives of Jesus Christ. We are the ambassadors of the kingdom of God on this earth. And these struggles and these battles are simply to distract us from who we are, to get us so worried and so wrapped up going on the hamster wheel in our own situations that we forget, exactly, that when we are pouring out the kingdom, amen, God pours the kingdom, yes, in us. Yes. When we will speak truth, we will let the river of God flow from us and minister to those around us, our needs are met.
Yes.
Our needs, yes, are met.
That's right.
We don't have to worry.
No.
We don't have to fret. We simply hold our peace and we look for those that need to hear the truth. That need to be set free in our lives all around us.
Yes. Amen.
So I encourage you, if you're struggling, stop fighting it. Stop fighting the battle. Just let it go. Trust the Lord. Have it out once for all in the prayer closet. And then look for someone to minister to.
Yes.
Look for those around you that are hurting. Look for those even in our body who need prayer and encouragement.
Amen.
And just pour out what God has already poured in you. Amen. You are precious. You are one with the King. You are one with the Savior. Your words have the power to save a life.
Amen.
Your words have the power. The words that Jesus spoke, we are representatives of his,
yes,
kingdom.
Yes.
And you are precious and you are wonderful and you are the light of the world,
yes,
in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Now, there are many of you who don't know me. I mean that in no blasphemous way. But we are representatives. We have been sealed by his Holy Spirit. We are one with him. We are new creatures. I don't mean any disrespect to God for those who don't know what I'm talking about, but we are representatives. So I encourage you, if you're hearing something that maybe you've never heard before, or if there's something that just says, I something feels yes, something in your spirit says yes, go to the scriptures.
Yes.
Search the scriptures. The Holy Spirit will be your guide. Amen. Any prayer requests or any testimonies this morning? Anybody? This is a safe place. This is a time where all members of our body come. We share our requests. Yes, Shelley.
My sister Katie was on life support on Wednesday. I drove her home from the hospital Friday.
Praise the Lord.
and praise the Lord with counseling and godly prayer and so forth, the advice and so forth, you know, it worked, you know, and it's helped our relationship, and it's just wonderful.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Stand and go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come before you this morning as we gather together in one mind and one accord. We lift up our praises, Lord, we celebrate the victory that you've given us in these circumstances. And we make our needs known to you, Lord. To be with Tina right now, Lord, the miracle needed. To touch her body, Lord, as she is healed by your stripes. In Jesus' name. Be with Leah this morning. Would you heal that infirmity in her, Lord? No sickness or disease can touch your people, Lord, that we have been healed by your stripes, Lord, that we were healed. We speak your word and we stand upon your word that must be true, Lord. That you have finished the work to be done, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you as you lead us and guide us. Lord, this morning we invite you in this house. Holy Spirit, come and have your way, Lord. We come to lift you up, Lord. We come to praise you. We come with hearts full of joy. We come with heavy hearts, Lord. But we have come. We have come into your house to drink from the river of life, to hear your word and be transformed by it. Renew our minds this day to think God thoughts. Help us to cast down the vain imaginations that would rise to pluck the seed of your word from our hearts. Let this be a place, a house of prayer. A house of prayer. You are welcome here, Lord. As we come to worship in spirit and truth, Lord, we don't wait, but we come to you this morning, Lord. Come, meet the needs of your people this morning. Minister, have your way in this service, Lord. As you lead and guide us by your spirit, give us eyes to see, give us ears to hear as we seek after you this morning. Let your heart be known. And this morning, Lord, bless the fathers and the husbands who pray and who work diligently for their families, Lord. Bless them. Bless them as we celebrate them this day, Lord. Jesus. And we bless our Heavenly Father this morning, who is the author of salvation, who formed the heavens and the earth, and who came as a man, Jesus, and died to redeem man to himself. Oh, you are a good, good Father. Help us to understand the breadth and the height and the depth of your love, Lord. Give us revelation every day of your true finished work, Lord, that it is finished. Let the work of grace have its full measure, Lord. And let us love. Let us love, holding nothing back, with no fear. Just love, and let your peace and your joy follow, Lord, and overflow from our cups. And we bless your name this morning, for you are a good, good Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Just a reminder that if you have a cell phone with you, to silence it or turn it off, please. And again, happy Father's Day to all of the husbands and fathers in the house. And let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Thank you, Lord.
Don and John, you want to come take the offering this morning? Don, would you ask the blessing this morning?
Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be here today, Lord. We're thankful for your goodness, your faithfulness, your mercy.
Thank you.
We just praise your holy name, Lord. We just ask that you will bless this offering, bless the service. May it be a stupendous service that we all remember. Something fantastic is about to happen.
Yes,
Hallelujah.
Lord.
We ask it all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. As the worship team comes forth, the Lord spoke to me a couple hours ago, specifically scripture out of Psalm 77. And Don unknowingly just touched on those same thing. Kennedy, don't laugh at my glasses, okay? It says, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders, O Lord, of old. I will meditate on all your works and talk of your deeds. Your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great as a God and our God? He is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
Father's Day has a special place in a lot of people of our hearts. God moved in so many ways years ago. But I know he's still moving. And I know the fire is still burning in a lot of those who experienced what happened over 20 years ago. The Lord has a new thing coming, and it's now amongst us. As I was working with some wood yesterday, I was splitting wood for 12 years straight. The Lord has provided firewood for our wood burner. I didn't sow the seeds. I didn't sow the trees. I didn't make them grow. I just had people call, a lot of tree trimming guys that I know and everything else. Some of them are customers, whatever, and say, hey, I got a load of wood. Do you want it? For 12 years straight, I've never had to buy firewood. And the Lord says, this is the way it is in the kingdom right now. The kingdom has been sown. People have been, for years, have been praying and praying, praying for the kingdom to come forth. He's just looking for people to harvest it in.
Yes.
And the time is now.
Yes.
The time is now, because the time is short and the Lord loves everyone.
Yes.
They may not accept him yet. But as time goes through, as we go forth from these walls and show his love, his grace, and his mercy, they too will come to know the love of the Lord.
Yes.
Because every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, he is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, he is Lord forever.
Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop praising his name, can't stop praising his name, just can't. can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus.
Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. The Prince of Peace, bright and morning star, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus.
Come on, guys.
Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus.
Come on, altos.
Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. Just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising his name, Jesus.
He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star.
Jesus Christ is Lord forever. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name. Can't stop praising his name. I just can't stop praising his name, Jesus.
Do you believe that, church? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, let's give him a word. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord.
You are worthy, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
I was blinded by the devil. Boy, were you ruined. Stone cold dead as I stepped out of the womb. By his grace I've been touched. By his word I've been healed. By his hand I've been delivered. By his spirit I've been sealed. I've been saved.
By the blood of the Lamb.
You've been saved. Come on, church. Come on, you've been saved.
I'm saved. By the blood of the Lamb. Oh, I'm so glad. Yes, I'm so glad.
Yes, I'm so glad. Are you glad?
Yes, I'm so glad.
I want to thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. By his truth I can be upright, by his strength I do endure, by his power I can be lifted, by his love I am secure. He crowned me with pride, freed me from the pit, full of emptiness and wrath, and the violent words of sin.
Yes, I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb. Yeah, I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb. I'm so glad. I'm so glad.
Yes, I'm so, so glad. Glad. Yes, I'm so, so glad. Glad. I want to thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I want to thank you, Lord. Let's praise him on the instruments. Me, nobody would dare. I was going down for the last time. By his mercy I've been spared. Not by words but by faith to him who is called. For long I've been hindered. For so long I've been sold. I've been saved
by the blood of the Lamb.
Yeah, I'm saved
by the blood of the Lamb. So glad,
yeah, I'm so glad,
yeah, I'm so glad.
I want to thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I want to thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I want to thank you, Lord. I want to thank you, Lord.
Yeah. awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God.
Fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, and he's riding a white horse across this land. He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, and he's riding a white horse all across this land. Calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, and he's riding a white horse across this land, and he's calling out, you and me, will you ride with me? And we say, yes, Lord,
yes, Lord,
we'll ride with you. And we say, yes, Lord, stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white. And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We will ride. Has a crown on his head, he carries a scepter in his hand, and he's leading the armies all across this land, and he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? Will you ride with me? And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, is his love for his bride, and he's longing that she be with him, right by his side. That fire in his eyes is his burning desire, that his bride be with him, right by his side. And he's calling out to us right now. Ride. We say yes, Lord. We will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white.
Right now, you need a touch from the Lord. Accept it right now.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Jesus.
We're all called to be kings and priests.
Jesus.
If you are led by the Lord to pray for someone, go for it. He's already released us to do it, church.
The city of our God. And there is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God. So I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be and it flows from Emmanuel's veins. It came and it healed me. It came and refreshed me. It came and washed my sins away.
Let's rejoice in the Lord. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Thank you, Jesus. We bless you this morning, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for never leaving us or forsaking us. Thank you for your faithfulness, Lord, even when we are unfaithful. Thank you for your grace and your favor, Lord. Thank you for every blessing we receive, every good and perfect gift that comes down from you, the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness nor shadow of turning. Thank you, Lord, for being the same. For loving us, for consistently loving us in our inconsistencies. We bless you this morning, Lord. We celebrate you and your goodness. Our Heavenly Father, thank you, Jesus. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give him a hand clap this morning if you will. Praise God. God bless you. All may be seated. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thanks, worship team. As always, great job. Amen. Appreciate the anointing on them and how God blesses us through them. Amen. I want to thank everybody for sharing your prayer requests and your testimonies. It's a privilege, amen, for us to be able to enter into agreement with you, whatever your need or the situation might demand. Amen. God is more than able. Thanks for the visitors that are here today. We appreciate you being here. Thank you so much. It's great to have all of you with us today. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. We'll let everybody find a spot. Praise God. The Sunday school kids can be dismissed to go downstairs. Normally they don't wait. So it's not like I have any authority over them. I just say that. So praise God. Amen. God is good. Everybody happy today? Praise
Amen.
The Lord. Happy Father's Day to all of the fathers. Amen. We appreciate them so much. And God is good. Hallelujah. Anybody feeling down, I'll just give you a little advice. Whenever I'm feeling blue, I just start breathing again. Praise the Lord. Start breathing because you turn blue when you don't breathe. Take this a little further. Everybody with me now. Praise the Lord. I see Don back there. Hallelujah. And Darlene. Good to see you guys. Praise the Lord. They're back for a little visit with family, and it's great to have them with us. Praise the Lord. All the way from Arizona. I feel so bad for them in the winter.
We feel bad for you.
I know you do. I feel the love, praise the Lord. But believe it or not, Iowa's not a bad place to be in the summer.
Really?
Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, well, let's get into this. You know, the other night, or Wednesday night, I guess it was, I was talking about some things. I want to just briefly touch on them because it kind of goes with in the context of where I want to speak to you about today. We know that Satan is against us. This message isn't about Satan, but he's real, you know, and we don't battle against flesh and blood. We battle against powers, principalities and powers, spiritual wickedness and so forth. So he tries to steal our position is what he's after. It's been that way from the very beginning with Adam and Eve. You know, the first thing he wants to do is challenge their relationship with God and try to destroy that, try to pull that apart. Amen. So he tries to steal our position. He tries to kill us spiritually. which is just being dead to God or being kind of numb to what God is trying to do in our lives. And by doing that, he can destroy our effectiveness, which is God operating through us. Amen? So I mentioned Wednesday night that we need to get back to a genuine understanding of God before the fall. Before the fall, God and man had a great relationship. Man was innocent, so God couldn't find any fault with him because there weren't any rules.
Right.
Amen. You know, rules are good, I guess, for some situations, but God really doesn't want rules. He wants relationship.
Yes.
He wants us to be able to interact with him without a fear of offending him or doing something that's going to cause us to feel a separation from him. Amen. So we've been redeemed, right? What have we been redeemed to? We've been redeemed back to innocence, back to the position where there is no law anymore. The law was fulfilled by Jesus, and so there is no law to condemn us.
Right.
And you know, y'all have heard the kind of a cliche, but it's still true. If there wasn't any speed limit out here on Interstate 80, you could drive as fast. It'd be like the Autobahn. You could drive as fast as you want. They couldn't give you a ticket because there's no law against driving as fast as you want. Right? The reason we get tickets is because there's a law posted that you can only go so fast, right?
Right?
Well, God has removed the law. Actually, what he's done is fulfill the law for those of us who believe.
Yes.
Now, the law is still valid. It's still in effect, but it's only the law is placing a demand on those who haven't come to Jesus, who has fulfilled the law. We come to Christ and believe in him, and he has accomplished every demand of a holy and righteous and perfect God. Now, if you don't come to Jesus, then there's only one other alternative, and that's keep the law.
Right.
And so far, nobody's been able to do that except Jesus.
Right.
So your odds are not really good, amen, if you don't come to the Lord. It's not a hateful thing. This is God's love wanting to give us, amen, a redemption that is total, that's complete, amen? Mm-hmm. And fortunately for us that are believers, there's a new garden. Amen. And Sheila, if you will, let's just go to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 10, and I can show you what that garden really is. Amen. It's a place where God has done everything, just like he did in the original garden. He provided everything. All Adam had to do was come and receive it. Right? So he says, "For he that has entered into his rest," God's rest, "he also has ceased from his own works as God did from his." That is the garden that God has provided for us, a rest where we no longer have to do things to get God's favor or to get God to like us or to love us or to accept us.
Right.
We rest in his finished work. And God does it all. It's like when Israel was going to go into the promised land, God told them, I've already won the battle. Just go. And it's a land that flows with milk and honey, houses you didn't build, fields you didn't plant. You just get to go and reap the benefits of it. That's the rest that God has for us. Satan's job is to steal that rest, to get us back into the work mode, to where God is no longer doing it. We're trying to accomplish it ourselves.
Right.
And again, we can't do it. This is a place that once we enter the garden, we're able to discover the good God, amen, that everybody is looking for. A God that loves, a God that's not there to beat you with a stick every time you screw up, but the good God, the God before the fall.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
And that's territory that Satan wants to steal from us.
Sure.
Just as he did from Adam and Eve. Because outside of rest, we're vulnerable. Outside of the garden, it's up to us, by the sweat of our brow,
sure,
to accomplish anything and everything. Praise the Lord. All right, let's get on with this now. Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18. I've got quite a few scriptures because I know that Sheila has insurance for carpal tunnel. Praise the Lord. So she can just do that thing. Praise the Lord. Okay, so Matthew 28, 18. "And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." Okay, all power. You don't need to know Greek or Hebrew to understand all power is all power.
Right.
So there's no other power outside of Jesus.
Right.
Amen? And how many of you know, if you're born again, if you have accepted Jesus as your Savior, you have him living in you. You have the power of God resident in you. That's not being arrogant or proud. That's just being in agreement with the Word of God. You have power. You have authority, just like Adam did. Amen? God's on your side. Praise the Lord. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verses 54 through 57. 1 Corinthians 15, 54 through 57. If you're a visitor and you think, man, we're just getting started with Scripture, but the reason we use so much Scripture is so that this is not just an opinion of mine, okay? I'm just trying to show you what the Word of God says, and then you can determine for yourself, like the Bereans. You know, they searched the Scripture to see if what Paul was saying was true, and you can do the very same thing. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?
Yes. Yes.
The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. Get this? The thing that empowers sin is not freedom. It's not liberty. It's the law.
Right.
The more law you got, the more sin is exposed.
Sure.
Back to the cliche, if there's no speed limit, there's no sin. There's no broken law. The moment that law comes in and says it's a 35-mile-an-hour zone and you drive 40, you've sinned.
Yes.
You broke the law. You could have driven 50 miles an hour up and down that road for 10 years and never had a problem. But the minute a law comes, there's the opportunity then to break it, to sin. Praise the Lord. So, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. He gave us the victory because he kept the law.
Yes,
he fulfilled it. So now we're victorious. We're more than conquerors because we didn't do anything except believe.
Exactly.
He's the victor. We just get to be the recipients of that victory. Praise the Lord. All right, Colossians chapter 2. Verses 9 and 10. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. All of fullness of Godhead dwelled in Jesus Christ the man bodily. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. That ought to tell you something about the authority and the confidence that God has in us. Praise the Lord. We need to start thinking bigger than us.
Yes.
We need to start thinking of something bigger than what we see in the mirror.
Exactly.
We are spirits created in the image of God, spirit beings, that have been given authority,
yes.
Have been given power.
Amen.
It's the power of God. It's not my power, but it's the power of God that's in me and can work Amen. Through me if I know it, if I'm aware of it,
exactly.
If I'm conscious of it. Amen? All right. Joshua chapter 1, verses 13 through 15. Joshua 1, 13 through 15, praise the Lord. I mean, you know, Joshua is the one that enters into the promised land, which is a type of rest, which is a type of trying to get back to the garden, amen? So remember the word which Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God hath given you rest and hath given you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your cattle shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side of Jordan, but ye shall pass before your brethren armed, all the mighty men of valor, and help them until the Lord hath given your brethren rest, as he hath given you. And they also have possessed the land which the Lord your God giveth them. Then ye shall return into the land of your possession and enjoy it, which Moses, the Lord's servant, gave you on this side of the Jordan toward the sun rising. So here's my take on this. There are people, we have the rest. We have the territory. We have the garden. We have this. But there are some who don't have it.
Right.
The battle is not for us to get the rest. The battle is for us to help them get the rest.
Come on. Yeah.
The battle is for us to bring them in to the
yes.
garden.
Yes.
The battle is for us to come against Satan on their behalf, because they don't have power over Satan, but we do. Amen. We have a weapon. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of these strongholds.
Yes.
Praise God. So we need to recognize the reality and the presence of the spiritual realm.
Come on.
We just go through life thinking this is, you know, that's my neighbor is a jerk.
No.
He may be a jerk, but it's actually a spirit, amen, that's your problem and not the neighbor.
Right.
Right. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. It's like they said, Somebody said, well, I killed him because it was I had temporary insanity. Well, that's really not a great defense for murder. People kill people. I mean, read the paper, right? I mean, temporary insanity is like when you break into somebody's house and do all their ironing. Murder, you get mad, you just do stuff, you know. So, praise the Lord. Amen. We need to move into life. We need to step into God's plan to heal our broken world. Amen. We need to move into this healing, into the power, and into the liberty, and into the truth of the finished work of Jesus. Amen. John chapter 10, verse 10. Satan comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And I'm come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. So Jesus doesn't want to just give us life. He wants to give us a life that goes beyond just a normal life. Amen. Exactly. Satan wants us dead. Sometimes physically, but always he wants us spiritually dead. Exactly. He wants us to feel separated from God. Sure. That's what happened to Adam when God said, the day that you eat of this tree, the knowledge of good and evil, so all of a sudden you're not innocent anymore because you know there are rules, you're going to die. Well, he didn't die physically then. He lived on for hundreds of years. But spiritually he died. He was cut off from that relationship that he had had with God, right? So 2 Timothy 3:16, and this is just kind of to get us into where I'm trying to go. Amen. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. That's where we're going here. Praise the Lord. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and instruction in righteousness. So everything in this Bible is profitable. If you know what it is you're reading. Amen? It's all profitable for what? For doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness. And we are the righteousness of God in Christ if we're born again. Mm-hmm. Yes. Praise the Lord. All right, so now I want you to go to Habakkuk, just because I like to say that. I don't use that scripture much, but Habakkuk 1:5. And I want to show you, I want to just try to show you a little something here today. Behold ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously. For I will work a work in your days, which you will not believe, though it be told you. Now, Habakkuk actually shows the destructive tactics of the devil, of Satan, how he operates. Amen? And there's a scripture in Acts chapter 13 that helps reveal the text from Habakkuk, because Scripture explains Scripture. It defines Scripture. Yes. And out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, you'll find, you know, things that will validate. One Scripture will validate another, is my point. So there's a Scripture there in Acts 13 that will help to open up this Scripture to us, I hope. Paul came to Antioch, and this is what's happening in chapter 13 of Acts. That's a city in Pisidia, and Paul speaks to this huge crowd. And the crowd is made up of two specific peoples, Jews and Gentiles. And we know that because the way he addresses them is he says, men of Israel and you who fear God. So there were two groups, two different kind of mindsets that he was dealing with. And that's in verse 16 where he says that. And Paul told him about Jesus, who he was, that he had come, that he had delivered them if they would believe in him. And he ends with this caution. He tells them, this is all you got to do to be saved. And then he gives them a warning or a caution at the end of it. And that caution that he gives them at the end is a quote from Habakkuk 1. So let's go there, if you will, now, Sheila, to Acts chapter 13. And we'll just read verses 38 through 41 where Paul is using this parallel to Habakkuk. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. That's for everybody. And that's good news. Beware, lest that come upon you which is spoken of in the prophets. Behold, and here's where he quotes it, behold, ye despisers, and wonder and perish, for I work a work in your days, a work which ye shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it to you. Praise the Lord. So Paul's saying Jesus died on the cross for your sins. He's the Messiah, the one you've been looking for, but you're going to have trouble believing because, and here is where Paul quotes Habakkuk, an enemy is trying to blind you. I'm paraphrasing, but that's what he's saying. An enemy is trying to blind you. Amen. Or you could use another metaphor. There's giants trying to keep the land that God has declared is yours. Amen. They're trying to take from you what God has already guaranteed to be yours. Amen. So what's so important about the Habakkuk quote? Well, let's go back to Habakkuk again. Chapter 1 and verse 5. I warned you, Sheila. Behold, ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days which you will not believe, though it be told you. All right, so he's warns of blindness toward an incredibly destructive enemy. And we know that because the next verse, verse 6, praise the Lord. Verse 6. For lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. Okay? He's raising up the Chaldeans, a bitter and hasty nation, which are going to march through the breadth of the land to possess dwelling places that don't belong to them, that are not theirs. Right? The Chaldeans. And then he describes them. Well, in Habakkuk's day, which was like 600, 605 B.C., the Chaldeans were idol worshipers. They were violent people who went about with the intent of possessing places that didn't belong to them, that weren't theirs. Nebuchadnezzar was a Chaldean. Chaldeans ruled over most of Babylon. When they conquered Judah, they stole everything that was in that land. They took everything. And they took it back to Babylon, and they left people there to control that area that wasn't theirs. They took back to Babylon everything, including the next generation. Satan's purposes are the same. They don't change. That's why the scripture says we should share. You know, listen, you know I don't rail about people not being in church on a regular basis. I wish that they were, but they're not going to hell if they're not. But if they're not, they better be talking to their children about God.
Exactly.
They better be telling them about the reality of God.
Yes.
And the reality of the enemy.
Amen.
Or they can be taken into captivity even if you're not. Praise the Lord. So, in Habakkuk, the Chaldeans are referred to as an actual people. But when Paul quoted it, he was actually describing the enemies of God. Amen? Spiritual entities who, like the Chaldeans, were determined to gain control over places that didn't belong to them. Satan and demonic forces. This is really upbeat, isn't it? I know you're really excited about this, but come on. It's a reality. And, you know, wouldn't you rather know the enemy? In fact, there's that old saying, you know, keep your friends close and your enemies closer. You know, you want the enemy behind you. Praise God. So how do we know? How do we know that this is what is going on here? Because by the time Paul talked about these Chaldeans being a threat, there weren't any Chaldeans. They were defeated by Cyrus of Persia in like 530-something B.C. They didn't exist anymore. So Paul couldn't have been talking about Chaldeans as a people or as a race or as a tribe. So it's obvious he isn't going to warn them about a group of people who don't even exist anymore. So who was he warning them about? Well, Chaldeans is translated wanderer, or the root word actually means to lay waste to or to destroy. That's where that's the actual meaning of the word. So historically, the Chaldeans conquered lands, robbed people, took their goods, took their belongings, took their property, and took them captive. So the metaphor, Chaldean, that Paul is using for his day and today is demons with some destructive goals and strategies. So back to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 10, which you don't have to go there, Sheila. We've read it, and I'm just saying. Back to the garden, back to rest, back to the territory that God has declared to be ours. They want to steal that. Yeah. They want to steal our minds, our health. And they do it just like the Chaldeans. Yeah. They're like invaders bearing down on unsuspecting people, and they try to steal your peace. They try to steal your joy. They try to steal your power.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And leave behind fear, anxiety, and stress. If you go back to Genesis 3, which you don't have to do again because I think most everybody knows that's the garden again, Satan is, first of all, a destroyer. Always wanting to control territory that isn't his so that he can lay waste to it. That's what the whole thing about was in the garden. He didn't want the garden. He just didn't want Adam and Eve in the garden. He destroyed what it was intended to be.
Right.
Like the Chaldeans are terrible, like they're dreadful, like they're fierce, so Satan. So are demons. They're not somebody you want to chum up with. You know, people joke around about, well, when I get to hell, we're going to party, you know, like it's 1999. I promise you. It could be a party. Praise the Lord. And that's as much as I'll say about hell, because none of us plan on going there, so we don't need to know any more about it, right? Praise the Lord. But let's look at this. Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 27. I promise to try to get a little positive here at some point. But this is a reality. If you don't know there's an enemy, you're not going to be armed. If you don't know that there's an enemy trying to steal what God has given you, he'll have it before you know you have it. He'll be possessing it before you even know it belongs to you. Her princes in the midst thereof are like wolves, ravening the prey, to shed blood and to destroy souls, to get dishonest gain, to steal what doesn't belong to them. Amen? Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 3. This is not only challenging that, but there you go. Her princes within her are roaring lions. Her judges are evening wolves. They gnaw not the bones till morrow. Acts chapter 20, verse 29. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Amen. How many of you know wolves are not nice? They don't make great pets. And the Lord didn't teach us about predators for animal control.
No.
There's a purpose in what he's telling us here about wolves. Wolves and sheep don't coexist.
No.
Wolves are always studying you. They may look like they're not paying any attention, but they're always kind of roaming around the herd to see if they can't spot a sick one, one that's lame, one that's a little older, slower, one that's isolated. And when the opportunity arises, they'll attack. And Satan's the same way. It says he goes around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Amen? He watches for weak times. He watches for isolated times. And that's when he attacks. Praise the Lord. John 8, 44. Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Anything that comes out of the devil's mouth is a lie. Anything that doesn't agree with this is either a lie or it's just stupidity. That's just the way it is. This is the final word. This is the word of God. This is the truth. There may be other facts, but this is the truth. Facts change all the time. All of us, no matter how young you are, living now in a technical age where, you know, the information age and so forth, it changes all the time. What was a fact when I was a teenager has been proven totally wrong in many, many cases.
Come on.
Amen. And most of y'all have been through the same stuff. You were taught certain things, and then you found out, well, that wasn't true, but it was a fact. So there are facts that may conflict with this, but there is no truth that can contradict it. Because there's only one truth, and this is it. His word is settled, amen, forever, in heaven. It's our job to settle it here. Praise the Lord. All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. In whom the god of this world, which is Satan, the god of this world has blinded the minds of them who believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So without belief in Christ, you're subject to constant manipulation and controls by an enemy. Amen. Luke chapter 8, verse 12. Satan wants to blind you. If you're saved, he wants to blind you to the power and the authority and the dominion that you have. If you're unsaved, he wants you just to blind you to Christ altogether.
Yes.
Those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil. So immediately you hear the word. And right away the enemy comes and tries to steal the word.
Sure, yes.
God tells you you have authority. God tells you you have power. God tells you, you by my stripes you were healed. And immediately Satan comes with a backache.
Yeah.
Amen. Confusion. Pain. This thing. That thing. Anything to distract you from the truth.
Absolutely.
So he tries to steal the word of God, which is the truth, as soon as you get it, before it can take root, before it can actually have an impact. Amen. He taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. And that word is sozo. It means more than just not going to hell. It means everything that God has purchased for you.
Yeah.
Your inheritance. Amen. Another strategy is accusation. Satan is the accuser of the brethren.
Yep.
So if you don't know that you're the righteousness of God in Christ, if you don't know that Christ has finished the work, if you don't know that you have a rest, that you can rest in God, and it's no longer your effort and your work that's going to keep you in relationship with God, he's going to come along and he's going to accuse you. He's going to say, you've sinned and God's mad. God doesn't love you anymore. God's abandoned you. Satan is a liar. Amen. He'll say, you're incompetent. You're unworthy. You're unacceptable. You're unlovable. You're powerless. You're disconnected. You can't meet the demands that God has. You can't be accepted by God because you're not perfect. But Jesus didn't die on the cross, amen, to give us just eternal life. He died and rose again to give us abundant life. Abundant life where there is no stress, where there is no anxiety about your relationship with God, where you are completely accepted in the beloved, where there's no longer any issue about you and God. You're good to go, amen, not just to heaven, but to whatever and however you want to do it here on earth.
Yes.
God will lead you and guide you into all truth.
Yes.
By his spirit, amen.
Yes.
He died and rose again to give us victory.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Victory in every situation, over every circumstance. Salvation and victorious living go hand in hand. They're synonymous. They're like, you know, you can't separate them. John 8, 32. See, we need to rise up and recognize we are powerful spiritual beings. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. Praise the Lord. And we have Christ in us, the hope of glory, and nothing shall be impossible to them that believe. Now, we say that stuff, but it becomes just kind of mumbo jumbo that we say, but we don't live it.
Exactly.
Come on.
And you can live it not because you're living a perfect life. You can live it because Jesus lived the perfect life and now has given you this inheritance.
Yes.
You do it not because God says, whoa, I've been scoping you out. You've really been good. It's not Santa Claus checking to see who's been naughty and nice. He knows all of us are naughty. I mean, I've used this before, and you all have heard it, I'm sure, in other places as well. But let me just remind you of this, if you're new here, if you just maybe haven't heard it. Maybe if you have, you need to hear it again. When it came time for a sacrifice, how many of you know all the sacrifices of the Old Testament were types and shadows of Jesus? He is the ultimate sacrifice, the final sacrifice, right? Well, when they would bring the sinner, whoever it was that had broken the law, their responsibility was to find an animal, in most cases a lamb, for a sin offering, and bring that lamb and present it to the priest, the high priest, for their sin offering. The high priest didn't look at the person who brought the lamb because he already knew they were a sinner, or they wouldn't be bringing a sacrifice. So he's not checking out the guy or the woman who brings the sacrifice. He checks out the sacrifice.
Exactly.
And if the sacrifice is spotless, if it's without blemish, then he lays his hands on the lamb, the sinner does, the lawbreaker, and the priest cuts the lamb's neck, cuts his throat, he bleeds out, and the innocence of the lamb comes upon the sinner.
Yes.
And the sins of the sinner go to the lamb.
Yes.
Now, Jesus is the spotless lamb. He is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So God is not looking at your sin. If you come to Christ in faith, he's looking at the sacrifice.
Yes.
The sacrifice has been determined perfect.
Yes.
Therefore, he has taken your sins and given you his righteousness. You are now the righteousness of God in Christ.
Yes.
And he has carried your sin as far as the east is from the west. You're not a sinner anymore. You may still sin, but you cannot be a sinner.
Exactly.
Just as when you were an unbeliever, a sinner, you did good stuff, but you it didn't make you righteous.
Right.
You were still a sinner.
Right.
It was a position.
Exactly.
That's what Satan doesn't want you to understand. He wants you to believe it's still about you.
Right.
Because you will still screw up. We all do. Either in thought or deed. And so we look in the mirror and we go, oh my God, you know, this is going to be a bad day because I really messed up. I got in an argument with my wife, or I flipped off the neighbor, or I did this, or I stayed too long at the well. You know, I was just, now I feel guilty and I feel ashamed. And, you know, somebody saw me, and that's why I don't have a pastor's thing on my truck. Man, I can lose it in traffic like anybody else. And so I didn't want them following me back to the church for. But I'm just saying, everybody is human. Everybody makes mistakes. And that's why we need a Savior. And that's what Jesus has provided. And he's done it so that we can be empowered to operate in the authority and the power of God without any sense of diminished capacity.
Sure.
Because of our weaknesses.
Exactly.
In our weakness, his strength is made perfect.
Exactly.
If you know who you are, nothing shall be impossible to you because God has already given you his favor.
Yes.
And nothing you can do can cause that favor to go away. We pray for favor, and it's
yeah.
like a, you know, it's like, why?
Yeah.
You don't need to pray for what you got.
Yes.
So sometimes our prayers are counterproductive because we're praying things that are really undermining who and what we really are.
Sure.
We are the righteousness of God in Christ.
Amen.
He says, as he is, Christ, seated at the right hand of God,
mm-hmm.
so are we in this present world. That sounds like blasphemy. That's what they accuse Jesus of. But that's what the scripture says.
Exactly.
You're like Jesus as far as God's concerned.
Yes.
Yeah. How about laying hands on the sick and seeing them recover?
Come on.
How about casting out some devils? How about doing what Jesus did because you've been given the authority? And it's not about you.
Yes.
It's about him.
Man,
I mean, this is like the greatest mother anybody. You know, some say he's got a face that only a mother could love. Hey, we all got faces that only a mother could love when it comes to our, our reality, who we are and what we do. But God is not just a father. He's our mother. He is our lover.
Yes.
He's got your little scribbled up life stuck on his refrigerator.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, it's important to him. He sees that this is beautiful.
Yes.
You see what Toby did?
Yeah.
And we look at it and we go, what a mess. And God says, no, that's beautiful.
Yes.
I got stuff on my refrigerator. I can't even find the handle half the time from grandkids that are always, and I don't have a clue, but I just say, oh, that's beautiful. If there actually was a picture there for them to color, it's just marks everywhere. Our lives are like this, but God says, it's beautiful.
Yes.
That's my child.
Yes.
It's my son, my daughter. I'm well pleased. Have a look.
Yes.
That's the hall of faith. That's Hebrews 11.
Come on.
Hebrews 11, you've got all these people that are dysfunctional.
Yes.
I mean, Abraham's a pimp. His own wife. He's a liar.
Yep.
Sarah laughs in the face of God when he gives her a promise. She goes, yeah, like, I'm going to have a kid at 99. And over and over and over, these people that when we read the stories in the Old Testament, they were failures. They were like us.
Yes.
But in Hebrews 11, all it says is, by faith,
yes.
Abraham, by faith, this happened. By faith. It's like God's picture on his refrigerator.
Yes.
And we're looking back here and we're seeing the mess, and God, all he can see is the beauty.
Uh-huh. Come on.
The perfection. Because they believed in me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because I am their father. That's what God wants you to understand. You have the potential of Christ in you, the hope of glory, so that nothing shall be impossible for you.
Amen.
If you can believe.
Right.
And until the church does that, we can have all the revivals that you want to talk about. But they're really not revivals. They may be awakenings, they may be reformations, but real revival is when the church realizes who the church is.
Yes.
And that'll turn this world upside down just like it did in the first generation.
Come on.
And that's what God is after. That's what the Holy Spirit is trying to get us to understand.
Come on.
Amen. I don't even know where I was, praise the Lord, but the war has been won.
Yes. Amen.
But battles still rage.
Sure.
And it's a battle for your mind. It's a battle for the truth. It's a battle for your rest. For your property, for your inheritance. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. We're doing good. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations. Everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now that doesn't mean we bring it in, we read that religiously as, well, you know, cast down any imagination, any negative thought, any bad thought, which is true. I'm talking about imaginations that come against you from the enemy that's saying, you can't do this, you're a jerk, you screwed up, you did this, you did that, you're always making a mess. Amen? Don't listen to that stuff. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. What is that? Principalities and powers in high places. The enemy. That's the devil. He's a liar. But he tries to convince you that his lies are the truth. And it can sound convincing because everything that comes out of his mouth is a lie. So it's like truth to him because that's all he ever does is lie. Amen? And so bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. That simply means every thought that comes against you about you having to do something to get God's favor, bring it into, think about it in terms of the obedience of Jesus. Jesus was perfectly obedient to God.
Yes.
And he has now transferred that obedience or the benefits of that obedience to you. So every time the enemy comes and tries to tell you what a jerk you are and how you screwed up and how God can't use you and you're such a mess and you don't know enough and all this other stuff, bring those things into the obedience of Christ. Bring them into the place where Jesus has already declared you righteous because of his perfection.
Yes.
Yes.
His obedience.
Yes.
Not your obedience. My obedience. Hey, it's like this. I mean, you know, you feel good one day and man, you're on fire and you're just really feeling the Holy Ghost. You just go out there and man, you're ready to set the world on fire.
Yeah.
The next day, you don't even want to get out of bed. It's everything. You're just overwhelmed. Ah, I'm so sick and tired of failure and missing and coming short. And we need to be consistent.
Yes.
Relax. Rest in the finished work of Christ. Because that is spiritual and it's mental.
Amen.
God given us power to destroy every enemy, every attack, and every stronghold of the devil. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 9. You know, I was once in an organization with a lot of truth and good people, but a lot of angry people too, a lot of bitter people, because you were always under another demand. There was always another thing you had to do. There was always more for you to do than what God had already done. People get frustrated. You ever work for somebody who was a perfectionist, who was never satisfied, who no matter how hard you tried to do it, it was never quite good enough? All the good that you would do, and they'd find the one little thing that wasn't right. And after a while, you get to the place where, in the church, they called it backsliding. In real life, it's just frustration. It's just, what's the point? Why keep trying to do something that is never going to be good enough? Just forget it. Let's just go on and be what we were, right? It's where I think the church has failed. God, you know, everything in the Bible talks about prophecy. All prophecy should edify. It should lift up. It should encourage.
Come on.
People should be encouraged. People should be edified. People should feel empowered. People should feel. You say, well, you're just giving them, you know, they're just going to go crazy. Hey, everybody's going crazy anyhow.
Yeah.
Let's let God worry about the crazy, and let's just tell him what God said and let him deal with it.
Yeah.
It's not our job to judge all of that. Our job is to give them the truth. Let them be empowered. And I'll bet you'll find that they'll be more godly, however you want to define that, by accident than they'll ever be by you giving them another rule to keep.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on those things. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Praise the Lord. Amen. If you can, Sheila, just drop to verse 13. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. That's coming right after this. See, when you quit dwelling on you and start dwelling on what Christ has declared you to be and what Christ has done for you, the next thing, you can do anything through Christ, amen, who strengthens you. Because it's no longer about you, it's about him. All right, verse 19. And it just gets better. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. All your need is supplied. Believe it. Live like that, and you'll see it happen. Praise the Lord. You'll see the reality of that. Amen. The word of God is a weapon.
Yes.
It's your weapon.
Amen.
And God himself is your fortress.
Come on.
God himself is your stronghold.
Yes, he is.
And I promise you this, the devil may come and mess with you, but he's not going to mess with God. He already tried that.
Yeah.
It didn't work.
Exactly.
And he knows better.
Right.
But if you know who you are in Christ, he'll treat you the same way he treats Christ. He'll avoid you like the plague.
Yes.
You've got power and authority over him. If you know that, and he knows that you know that, he doesn't want to mess with you.
Right.
He'll find some other weak, isolated.
Sure.
Right? He's the wolf. He's looking around. And if he sees the head honcho, whatever they call the head wolf, whatever, capital W, he don't mess with him. He messes with the weak ones, the little ones, the insecure, the ones that don't know. Praise the Lord. We war in spiritual realms. And greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. Yes. Praise the Lord. Back to Habakkuk again. We're about to wrap up here. Habakkuk 1 and verses 5 and 6. Behold ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days which you will not believe, though it be told you. Trying to blind us. Raise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. That's where we're at. The enemy, as Paul warned, is trying to blind us to who we are and to our authority and to our power and steal our possessions. Steal our territory, steal our rest, and steal everything that goes with that rest. When you rest in God, all the other things that we just read about, amen, in Philippians, go out the window. Amen?
Amen.
All right, Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. So we can... I mean, I see this positive, but what do I know? Amen. Praise the Lord. I will stand upon my watch, set me upon the tower, and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I'm reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. We are victorious.
Amen.
We are more than conquerors.
Yes.
In spite of what we see, in spite of how the devil tries to blind us, get the vision.
Amen.
Write it on the wall. Keep focus. Amen. And it will. It has to come to pass. If God said it, it has to happen.
Yes. Amen.
It has to happen.
Yes.
No matter what the devil's saying or what the devil's trying to do.
Come on.
Amen. All right. Verse 14. Same chapter. For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
Yes. Yes.
Praise the Lord. I want to be there for that. Hallelujah. The waters cover the sea. That means pretty much everywhere.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. You can't escape it.
Amen.
Amen. It's going to be known. It's going to be revealed. It's going to be seen. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
All right. Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. This is the end of the scriptures. Sheila breathes a sigh of relief. Hallelujah. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines, the labor of the olive shall fail, the fields shall yield no meat, the flock shall be cut off from the fold, there shall be no herd in the stalls. How many times have you been there? Someplace in there.
Yep.
Amen. This looks like everything's being taken, everything's being, you know, you're believing for healing and there's no healing, there's just more pain. You're believing for a financial breakthrough and just another bill comes. Amen. You're believing for, you know, restoration, and it's just more chaos.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. Everything's going south. Yet, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. That's called faith, because the Lord God is my strength, and he will make my feet like hind's feet.
Yes.
That doesn't mean rear feet. That means like goat feet. That can run through the rocks and the cliffs and never have to worry about falling or being damaged. They can get in anywhere. Amen. Hind's feet. And he will make me to walk upon my high places to the chief singer on stringed instruments. Praise the Lord. So God is saying, believe me when it doesn't look to be true. That's called faith. You know, Jesus told Thomas, he said, you believe and you're blessed because you believe, but you believe because you've seen something here to believe in. But more blessed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
We look at things that are not as though they are.
Yes.
Amen? We don't walk by sight. We walk by faith.
Yes.
And our faith produces the reality of what God has said.
Yes.
Then it becomes tangible. It becomes visible. But it's already real because everything begins in the spirit and moves into the natural world. Amen?
Amen?
It doesn't get here without somebody believing for it.
Exactly.
Praise God. So keep your focus. Keep your confidence in the finished work of Jesus and not you. And when you do that, you disarm the enemy and he flees.
Yes.
Amen.
You are more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And we have a resting place. Don't let the enemy steal it with just a bag of lies. Amen?
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand clap like you really mean it. Amen. You need to listen to those scriptures and you need to believe them. Nothing is impossible if you can believe. And you say, well, I believe, but how about the guy that said, I believe, but help my unbelief? He still got the healing.
Yeah.
He still got the miracle. It isn't our perfect faith. It's actually it's the faith of Christ.
Amen.
And we believe in his faith that he exercised to accomplish everything that the law demanded so that we could be free of it.
Yes.
So that we could be more than conquerors, so that we could be the righteousness of God in Christ. Leave here with that kind of knowledge and keep reminding yourself. Amen. You don't always have a CD to listen to or a preacher to try to, but just keep telling yourself. That's all you got to do. You have authority and it comes from your mouth.
Amen.
Speak it, amen, to yourself and then walk in it. And just thank God that in my weakness, his strength is made perfect. Amen. God bless all of you. Have a great Father's Day. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.